Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 4th February 2019. Today we will be discussing these five topics. The first topic is related with Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty. The second is related with the request for a new waiver for Iranian oil submitted by Indian oil marketing companies. The third one is related with the labeling for GM food products in India. The fourth article is related with the interim budget. How the announcement made in the interim budget 2019-20 would act as a booster dose for consumption and investment. And the fifth is related with Kaizenor forest disease. Let's move to the first article. The first article is related with the recent suspension of INF treaty by Russia and USA. In 1987, US President Ronald Reagan and Soviet USSR leader Mikhail Gorbachev, they came to an agreement titled Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, that is INF Nuclear Deal. This treaty acted as an icebreaker during the Cold War. The Cold War between USA and USSR was marked with increasing arms race. It created a sense of vulnerability and danger for other countries in the world. So, in order to curtail the threat posed by the arms race, these two countries, USA and USSR, they both came to an agreement which is commonly known as INF nuclear deal. Why it is in news? Because recently United States and Russia, they both have suspended their compliance with INF treaty. And both of them have traded charge against the other party, citing that they are violating the INF treaty. And the one party being violator and the other party still complying with the INF treaty would make the complying party to be weak. So both the parties, USA and USSR, they have suspended their compliance with INF treaty. This INF treaty is focused on eliminating intermediate range and shorter range missiles between both the countries. The INF treaty eliminated all land-based ballistic and cruise missiles. Not only missiles and also their launchers were eliminated. We all know that any missile is calibrated, any missile is denoted by its range. These land-based ballistic and cruise missiles eliminated by this INF treaty had the ranges of 500 to 1000 kilometers under the short-medium range, and in the intermediate range, they were under 1000 to 5500 kilometer. When the deal was signed in the year 1987, it created a glimmer of hope for the people. Now with the arms race getting into the center stage, like China is developing new highly advanced weapon system, Russia is working on a supersonic missile system, USA is also working on similar lines. This competitive arms race will create disturbances to the equilibrium existing in the world. Measures has to be undertaken in order to avoid this arms race turning out to be a full-scale war. Let's move to the next topic. The second is related with the extension of waiver sought by oil marketing companies in India. With implementation of CARTSA, US government threatened sanctions on the countries which import goods from Iran and Russia. As far as Iran is concerned with, India is second largest oil import from Iran. India was importing 341 thousands of barrels per day. And replacing such important oil exporter to India was not sustainable. So what we did, we asked for a waiver from the US. And the waiver was provided on the condition that Iranian oil purchase should be restricted to 1.25 million tons. Or 9 million barrels a month. If oil marketing companies are obliging to this condition, then no sanction would be applicable on India. This was the terms on which the waiver was offered. Even before that, the oil marketing companies in India, they had planned to improve the or they had planned to raise the import of crude from Iran to 30 million tons by 2018-19. And now replacing or refacing those targets becomes unsustainable and would create a demand-supply mismatch in Indian oil market. So, the oil marketing companies have demanded for an extension of the existing waiver or a new waiver to provide in relief to the Indian oil marketing companies. The fact which we should remember here is that Iran is the third largest oil producer among the OPEC countries. And India is world's third largest oil importer. Let's move to the next article. The third one is related with the labeling of GM food crops being undertaken by FSSAI in India. FSSAI, the premier organization under central government, is the nodal authority for issuing food licenses in India. When we speak about food security covers two areas. One is quantity and the other is quality. The quantity factor of food security is provided by the PDS and the other measures taken by the government to provide food grains to the economically vulnerable section of the society. And at the same time, the quality, there has been adulterations happening in the food products. There has been mislabeling of products. There has been genetically modified food products being supplied in the market. There has been pesticide used food items being sold in market as organic products. In order to curtail all these, the government has brought in few labeling and few standardizing measures. One such measure was introducing the Jaivik Bharat logo for organic food products. And in the recently, FSSAI has introduced labeling for genetically modified food crops. And as per the new rules, as per the new guidelines issued by FSSAI, labeling is required if the GM content is over than 1%. That is, if the maximum residue level of the genetically modified ingredients reaches 1% of the total value or total volume of the food product, then the package of the food product must indicate that it has genetically modified content. Earlier, the scientific committee of FSSAI was considering about providing a 5% threshold value. But having discussions with various stakeholders, this threshold was kept down at 1%. Indian food products, they have huge market in abroad, mostly in European and American continent. And the consumers in those markets, they are aware of genetically modified food crops. So, in order to boost, in order to create an viable, sustainable market for Indian food products over there in abroad, the licensing becomes more important. Also, many of the countries like Australia, New Zealand, Japan, South Korea, Brazil, China, Europe, they have mandated GM labeling. This move of FSSAI to introduce labeling for GM food products, apart from providing information, it also creates market situation, creates market position for Indian food exporters. This kind of labeling was necessitated because of a recent survey undertaken by Center for Science and Environment. In 2018 July, they undertook a survey based on which they found that more than the majority of the food products available in Indian product, they do have traces of GM material. This study initiated FSSAI to introduce labeling for GM crops. Apart from the threat posed by genetically modified components or traces of genetically modified organism in food products, there are also few threats posed by the antibiotics used in food products, mostly in the poultry sector, also in fishery sector. The fishery sector, like the inland fisheries, they make use of antibiotics. FSSAI has been working out on a policy to limit the use of antibiotics in food products. And this is not going to be a carte blanche ban on antibiotics in food products. Food antibiotics will be permitted, but it will be allowed only if they are below the threshold limit prescribed by FSSAI. Recent initiatives undertaken by FSSAI, the quality of food products available in India is going to increase. Let's move to the next article. The fourth article is speaking about the provisions of interim budget 2019-20 and how these provisions, how these announcements made in the budget will have impact on consumption and investment in India. The interim budget 2019-20, interim budget for the fiscal year 2019-20 has few announcements and provisions on improving the disposable income of the individuals. This increase in disposable income is facilitated by tax rebates for people earning less than 5 lakhs and a 10,000 rupees hike in standard deduction. And the TDS threshold on small savings scheme has been increased from 10,000 to 40,000. So, by providing all this, the government is aiming to improve the disposable income of the people. When the disposable income is increasing, the increase in disposable income has two positive implications for economy. The one is increase in consumption, the other is increase in savings. Both consumption and saving plays a crucial role in a health of an economy. Apart from increasing the disposable income through these initiatives, the government has injected 95,000 crore rupees into the farm economy through the PM Kisan scheme. This scheme would help in boosting the consumption from the primary sector. How this consumption and investment are interlinked? In order to understand this, we have to look into this image. In order to understand the interlinking between consumption and investment, we have to look into this image. The investment goods sector is nothing but an household. The consumption goods sector is nothing but market or the producer of goods. Say for example, a household is receiving income in wages and profits. And this wage can be used for consuming a particular goods produced by the market. And by selling those particular goods, the market is gaining some profit. This profit will be used for consumption again. This way, high disposable income or higher wages or higher profits would boost consumption in the economy. At the same time, the household, after spending a amount on consumption, it will use the remaining part for savings. When it is being used for savings, it will be used as an investment. With the demand for particular type of goods getting increased in the market, the household savings can be invested back as bonds, golds, and other investment methods. The same applies for the market also. The savings from the market will be invested, and this investment would be creating demand among the households for particular good. This way, consumption and investment act in tandem, act in pair to improve the health of an economy. So the interim budget has few provisions. One important provision is about the announcement made along the lines of improving highways in India. So this development of new highways and improvement of the existing highways quality would create situation for commercial vehicles and tractors in India. So as we discussed earlier, this high disposable income would rekindle or would re-invoke demand for the consumer goods from middle and lower state of the economy. We all know that due to global trade war, the export growth is weakening. Since export is getting weakened, it is pertinent for us to create a domestic market. The domestic market would help in sustaining of our industries. So high disposable income would also create a chance for domestic industries to sustain. This is an important positive point. The domestic market will be provided impetus by the private consumption. And this private consumption accounts for 55% of GDP. This would act as an important driver in providing strength to the domestic market. An economy is always a composition of positive and negative thing. Whenever there is a positive aspect, it would lead to a negative aspect. High consumption is a positive thing, but at the same time, high consumption will also kindle the fires of inflation. The recent survey undertaken by Crisil indicates that inflation rate in India from 3.7% in the present fiscal to 4.5% in the next fiscal. So the government has to undertake measures to curtail this inflation in order to reap the positive benefits arising out of this boosting consumption. Apart from this, there are other external factors like monsoon and crude oil. The monsoon has been adequate for the past 4 years and the price of crude oil is stabilized now. If these two factors continue for the forthcoming year, then our GDP could grow at 7.3%. With the provisions in budget boosting disposable income, it is up to the government to maintain the macroeconomic stability in order to reap the benefits arising out of it. And the last article is related with Kaizanur forest disease. For the past few weeks, we have seen news items carrying the spread of Kaizanur forest disease. So it becomes imperative for us to understand the basics, understand how this Kaizanur forest disease is spreading in the vicinity. So this Kaizanur forest disease is a virus-borne disease. This virus is transmitted to humans when the humans are bitten by a tick or when humans come in contact with infected animal. Here the infected animal means monkeys and small mammals. The virus also infects large mammals like cows, buffaloes and all, but cows and buffaloes, they don't play a role in transmission. It's only monkeys and small mammals, they play a role in transmission. Let's see the life cycle of Kaizanur forest disease. First, an adult tick, it lays eggs and from eggs come out larva. The larva are ingested by the monkeys or small mammals like rodents. The nymphs of tick, they also affect the monkeys or small mammals. And the adult ticks, they attack, the adult ticks, they bite either larger mammals like cows or they directly bite the humans. the humans who have more exposure to forest areas. As we discussed earlier, the disease is spread by two ways. The virus is transmitted to humans in two ways, either from already affected monkeys or small mammals. And the second way of spread is direct bite of a tick. So when humans come to contact with this adult tick, they acquire this disease. At the same time, when humans come in contact with these monkeys or small mammals, the virus is transmitted to the humans. The rhesus monkey or the common monkey in Indian forest, it is the main host of the Kaizanur forest virus. This disease is prevalent along the Western Ghats region. The governments are taking steps in order to curtail the spread of Kaizanur forest disease. Thank you.